In the history of the Chernobyl disaster, there are defining stories that unfolded so rapidly that no or very little evidence remained of them. One such story is that of a cableway constructed over the reactor for radioactive aerosol studies. Its legacy lies in a brief scientific report and a blast opening in the power plant building. Yet, this project shaped the design of a critical part of the Chernobyl sarcophagus. This is its story. Radiation is likely the first thing that comes to mind when we talk about the Chernobyl disaster even today. Back in 1986, it was no different. Radiation exposure could be reduced using shielding, time management, and increasing distance from the source. But what if the source is inside the human body? One of such sources was the fine airborne dust. Carried by the wind, it could be inhaled, posing a direct threat. Actually, in the summer 86, aerosols became the greater problem than the radiation levels. This is the reason why before the construction of the sarcophagus started, the area around was cleared as much as possible. Rooftops and nearby zones littered with highly radioactive debris were cleaned. Heavy machinery stirred up dust, requiring constant dust suppression. But despite these efforts, one source would remain, the reactor itself. Sealing it all hermetically was not an option, as a lack of air circulation theoretically could change the fuel's temperature and behavior. So engineers realized that the sarcophagus needed a sophisticated forced filter ventilation system connected to the VT2 vent stack. But for the design, inaccurate data was essential. This task was assigned to scientists from the Kurchatov Institute's comprehensive expedition, including Boris Ogorodnikov. He arrived in the zone on May 4, just a week after the Chernobyl disaster. At that moment, Ogorodnikov had incredible 27 years of experience in aerosol studies in a team of Igor Petryanov. Petryanov, Ogorodnikov and their colleagues were creators of sophisticated fiber-based filtering materials. Exactly on their filters are based those famous white respirators you can see in almost every Chernobyl chronicle or picture. And in the following years, their creations became an essential element of Chernobyl research. But back in May, it had to solve a challenging task. Since their arrival, Ogorodnikov's team had monitored aerosols using helicopters. However, they couldn't descend below 200 meters or 650 feet or hover for long due to extreme radiation and rising turbulent airflows. Worse, the helicopters created their own air currents, making accurate sampling nearly impossible. A new approach was needed. So the team designed a special sampling container. It housed gas cylinders for analyzing radioactive gases like krypton and xenon, multilayer filters for measuring aerosol dispersion, and sensors to evaluate gamma radiation. By late June, the system was ready for deployment, but then the disaster struck. During a flight over the reactor, the container swayed violently. All of a sudden, a sharp piece of rebar sliced the cable, sending the container and its data onto a ledge of Unit 4 western wall. So, a new solution was urgently needed. It was proposed by the team of Arnold Shastin. At that time, Shastin was the head of the Workshop of Control Systems at Bayer, a service organization for the Belyarsk nuclear power plant. Previously, he was directly involved in the deployment and operation of German robots, including the infamous Joker and MF3. His workshop also created a less fancy but far more effective robot called Beloyarets, which you might have seen in exhibit if you ever visited the city of Chernobyl. But this time they created something entirely different, a cableway. The idea was simple: stretch a durable cable over the reactor along which a trolley with a basket would move. The basket would carry up to 40 kilograms of equipment. The cable was mounted on a winch, allowing it to be lowered closer to the reactor core if needed. This setup allowed for various spots to be covered and samples to be obtained undisturbed by unwanted airflows. By late August, the cableway was ready. We could find the original report from Boris Ogorodnikov, which he presented at the conference in 1987. It explained what happened next. First, in room 7001, located beneath the ventilation stack, a hole was made in the wall using an explosive charge. Then, from this opening, using a harpoon gun, a steel cable was fired on the remnants of the western wall of Unit 4. It crossed the former active zone at a height of 35 meters or 115 feet. The cable was just like a pencil thick, so it took us a good time to find it in this mesh of other cables and scratches on the paper, but here it is. Between August 28 and September 12, 11 samples were collected above the reactor. Three of them came from hole 6001, using a long rod with attached filters. Eight other samples were taken on different heights using the trolley. At different stages, different types of electric blowers were installed in the basket, pumping between 12 and 100 liters or 3 to 26 gallons of air per hour. This is because in different days they were equipped with different types of filters. AFA analytical filters were used to get concentrations of radionuclides, while packages of three Petrarov filters of various densities were used to understand the dispersion of particles. All this sampling was finished just a few days before the roof started to be assembled over the destroyed reactor. But to get a comprehensive picture, additional sampling was conducted a few hundred meters away, near the ABK2 administrative building of the power plant. The exposed filters were processed on a spectrometer with a Nokia 4900B impulse analyzer. That allowed the team to identify which radionuclides were present in those aerosols, their concentration, activity, and particle size. But to make conclusions, the team also used more data obtained during this period. This data came from buoys, the rug detection nodes installed on the surface of the destroyed reactor, which we told you about in one of our previous episodes. Along with thermal and radiation sensors, each was equipped with 6 anemometers, which helped understand the power and speed of rising air. This was additionally combined with the weather observations made at the meteorological station in the city of Chernobyl and the samplers around the power plant. And altogether, this brought very surprising discoveries. First, the concentration of nuclides in aerosols right above the reactor debris was only a few times higher than what was actually permitted for the normal operation of the power plant. With further travel, it would become drastically lower, which was acceptable for the disaster zone. Second, it was found that at that point, what was coming out of the reactor was no longer playing any significant role in adding contamination around. And finally, natural airflow appeared to be completely sufficient to keep everything inside enough cold. These three facts led to a major change in the design of the sarcophagus and eventually made its operation much easier. So, according to the original idea, inside the ventilation center it was planned to install a powerful forced ventilation system equipped with a set of filters. After passing through the filters, the air cleaned to acceptable limits was to be exhausted through the ventilation stack. But as it was discovered that contamination is significantly lower than it was expected, it changed the plans. The system was actually built, but as a reserve one, to be used only in the case of severe changes in aerosol parameters. An additional bypass valve was added, which allowed for natural airflow. To keep everything under control, aerosol sensors that had been damaged during the disaster were restored inside the chimney. And later, an extensive dust suppression system was added inside the sarcophagus. And in reality, since then, there were no single case where there was a need to switch the vents from bypass to filters. Of course, all the solutions were a compromise, because it was later discovered that the sarcophagus had multiple unwanted openings caused by technological limitations of its construction. But now, with the new safe confinement installed in position, providing a sealed, air-conditioner environment, this chapter is largely closed. Arnold Shastin made three work trips to Chernobyl zone between May and October 1986. He continued his work at Bayer for many years and later became a university professor. From what we know, he is 84 now. Boris Ogorodnikov continued his research work in Chernobyl and over the years became one of the leading scientists on the problems of the sarcophagus. He wrote numerous scientific articles, and in 2008 he published a fundamental work on radioactive aerosols in the shelter object. He passed away in 2018 at the age of 83. Their work, though technical and often unknown to the general public, was one of those efforts that defined the future of the Chernobyl zone. We will continue to explore more stories like this in our future episodes. Until then, check out our Patreon for translated original reports about the Cableway and Program Buoy, as well as such unique archive materials as never published photos of Kurchatov expedition and other unique insights into Chernobyl as a phenomenon. This episode is a part of a series, so check out our other documentaries because we have many fascinating stories to share. Thank you for watching and see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.